Macmillan Audio presents I Do Not Trust You by Laura J. Burns and Melinda Metz. Read for you by Samantha Desz. The Boston Record. Gregory A. Engel, an influential scholar of archaeology and linguistics, was killed Thursday in a small plane crash northeast of Mumbai, Maharashtra, India. He was 46. Dr. Engel received his doctorate in linguistic anthropology from the University of Sheffield in 1994. In 1996, he traveled to the Upper Nile Valley to study the transliteration system used by Egyptian priests after the invasion of Alexander the Great, beginning the work he would continue until his death. A research paper Dr. Engel published in 2017 posited that the language of the Horus priests lasted at least 500 years after the last known appearance of hieroglyphic script. His hypothesis was based on the discovery of writings in the secret language of the priests on paper carbon dated at approximately AD 900. Dr. Engel received the R.R. Hawkins Award, which recognizes outstanding scholarly works in all disciplines of the arts and sciences, for the paper. Dr. Engel was preceded in death by his wife, Dr. Daisy Leong, a physician with Doctors Without Borders. He is survived by his daughter, Memphis Leong Engel. Chapter 1. The lotus flower was wrong. Its loop bent down where it should bend up. No matter how she translated it, the phrase didn't make sense with the lotus this way. Sorry, Dad, Em thought. I know you wanted it to mean the Nefertum Temple, but it's not. The flower just isn't right. Memphis, are we boring you? Em's attention snapped back to her teacher, who wore the same slightly exasperated expression she had every time they interacted. Ms. O'Malley was cool enough and pretty smart, but she didn't know history like Em knew history, and that was the one thing they both knew. Nope, Rome is my second favorite empire, Em replied. Ms. O'Malley narrowed her eyes, trying to figure out if this was scolding-worthy behavior. Em held her gaze. Just make sure you're listening while you doodle, Ms. O'Malley finally said. Always. She went back to her lecture, and Em went back to her hieroglyphs. Her doodles. They had helped win her father the R.R. Hawkins Award a few years ago, and they would be the subject of the first scholarly article Em published once she got her doctorate. But there were only two people left in the world who could read them. To everyone else, they were just doodles. Maybe the lotus flower wasn't actually a lotus flower, and the phrase didn't mean the little shrine to the god Nefertum. It had been a long shot anyway. She and Mike had only taken up this part of the translation because Em's father had started it already, so they had something to go on. If only she could sit in a room with Dad like always, puzzling over the tiny pictograms together with a bowl of M&Ms nearby. But that part of her life was over. She would have to finish translating the map without him. Em shook her head. Wallowing didn't get work done. That's what Mom always said. Or at least that's what Dad had told her, Mom said. The memories of Mom weren't as strong as they once were. Now she was mostly someone Em remembered through Dad's stories. Who knew where the line was between truth and memory? Mike said it didn't matter, that love was the only part of the story that mattered. That's ludicrous. Nick Washington's voice broke into her thoughts. You're assuming the church didn't know exactly what they were doing. They were missionaries, their whole job, Brianna Lynn started. They were conquerors. Nick's face was smug. His voice was smug. Em was pretty sure his soul was smug, too. It was his defining characteristic. The church didn't take over the world by being tolerant. They wanted everyone to think like them, so they made everyone pray like them. You can't keep your local god unless you start calling it your local saint. The church isn't an empire. Rome was an empire, Brianna argued, sounding more on edge. Nick had that effect on people. In fact, there is little evidence the church appropriated pagan gods, Ms. O'Malley pointed out. Oh, everyone knows it. Even the holidays used to be pagan holidays, Nick said. Like Christmas or Easter, they were pagan festivals before the church took them over. You want to talk imperialism? That's imperialism. The Roman Empire let people keep their own gods. They were tolerant. Brianna didn't answer. She looked ready to cry. Em sighed. Nick's debating style was basically to be a bully. Em didn't like bullies. They weren't tolerant. You're just ignorant of their worldview, she said calmly. All eyes in the room went to her. Nick's face lit up. He loved a new victim, or a new sparring partner. He only cared about the fight. He didn't have to believe what he was fighting for. I don't think I've ever been called ignorant before, he drawled. He was going to Yale in the fall and worked it into conversation at least once a day. Not to your face, maybe, Em replied, earning an ooh from her classmates. The Romans didn't give a crap about the gods of their conquered territories. They were polytheistic. They simply did not have the concept of my god is the only god, so all other gods are false. To them, it didn't matter if their conquests worshipped other gods. All that mattered was that they paid taxes. Meanwhile, the Catholic Church held a monotheistic worldview, so they rejected other gods. They didn't view it as imperialism. They viewed it as doing God's work. It doesn't matter why they did it. They still stamped out native religions, Nick argued. The why is the only thing that matters. If you don't understand how people thought at the time, then you don't understand history, Em told him. The Romans weren't being nice. If they saw a local god as a threat to their power, they stamped out that god just the way the church did. But they did it for financial reasons, for security reasons, not for theological reasons. But that doesn't fit your narrative, I guess. Nick's eyebrows drew together, and for a moment, he seemed at a loss. Ms. O'Malley pounced. Okay, enough debate. We were talking about the expansion of the Roman Empire, not the implications of their religion. She shot Nick a frown, while Brianna smiled at Em. Nick gave an unconcerned shrug, but Em knew he hated when he didn't get the last word. Almost as much as she hated when clueless people tried to show off. You should have seen Miss Memphis here get into it with Nick last period, Brianna said, squeezing in between Em and Inez at their usual spot in the cafeteria. She shut him down with her crazy ancient cultures voodoo. He's an ass. He's lucky he's hot, their friend Ayana commented, waving her spork in Nick's direction. Em shrugged. I wouldn't try to debate him in physics. I just know more about Rome than he does. What about AP Chem? Would you debate him in that? Inez asked in a fake serious voice. Would you debate him in German class? She'd debate him in German, Brianna joked. And if he tried to fight back, she'd switch to Greek. Em threw a French fry at her. I can't help it. I grew up speaking different languages. And learning about pharaohs and becoming well-versed in the history of the Etruscan people, Ayana said, putting on a fake accent that was probably supposed to be British. Oh, and setting broken bones in the bush. That only happened once, Em muttered. Her friends laughed. Anyway, it was epic. Thanks, Brianna said. I can't stand fighting with people, and Nick always goes after me. He knows you hate it, Em pointed out. That's why he does it. An ass, like I said, Ayana shrugged. You think he's coming to the party tonight? Brianna asked. Probably. Everyone else is, Inez replied. Even Memphis. Em made a face. Anything to get out of the house. Bob and Liza would expect me to play board games with them otherwise. Her friends exchanged a glance. Em winced. No offense. Oh, you were offending someone? Nick piped up from behind her. Good girl. Immediately, Bree looked down while Ayana rolled her eyes. Inez just smirked, glancing back and forth between Em and Nick. I was not offending anyone. I only meant I don't like parties, Em said. She didn't bother to turn toward him. It didn't matter. He inserted himself onto the bench next to her anyway. A little tingle ran up her spine as the scent of his cologne hit her nostrils, spicy and warm. They're boring. Everyone talking about the prom or the senior trip or whatever. I'm over it, Nick said. Me too, thought Em, wishing she didn't agree with him. She loved her friends, but even they were all about high school. Em just didn't care. High school was nothing more than what she had to get through before she could leave. After the crash, after the shock of Bob and Liza becoming her guardians, she'd asked if she could go off to college early, either Boston University or the University of Sheffield in England. Both had the kind of archaeology program she wanted and would have let her in with no questions. They knew her father. They knew high school was a waste of time for someone like her. But her guardians said no. They said she needed stability and normalcy after losing her dad. Never mind that traveling the world and taking care of herself was normal for her. While she and Dad technically lived in Boston, she'd never spent more than a few months there during the school year. They traveled, half the year spent on digs. She missed it. What's with this thing, anyway? Is it to fight off bad guys? Nick teased, finding an excuse to touch her. He reached for Em's collapsible bow staff, tucked in the inside pocket of her jacket, like always. But before he touched it, before his flirty smile registered in her mind, Em had already grabbed his hand, twisted it back to the breaking point, and used the pain to push him off the cafeteria bench and onto the floor. With her other hand, she whipped out the stick and shoved it up against his throat. Em froze. He's just hitting on you. Her friends were aghast, and everyone nearby watched open-mouthed. Nick's eyes were wide with panic. Sorry, Em stood up, leaving Nick on the floor. I'm really sorry. Freak, he muttered, climbing to his feet. He glanced around, noticing the barely concealed laughter from onlookers. Geez, I just wanted a fry, he joked, as if he hadn't been humiliated, then hurried out of the cafeteria. What the hell? Inez asked. He was flirting with you and you beat him up. I know, Em groaned, shoving her staff back into her pocket. I didn't mean to, it was just reflex. Her friends were silent. She'd freaked them out. Should she explain the years of self-defense and martial arts training? That she and Dad ended up in some rough places? Her friends lived in a city. They understood danger. Sort of. In a nice, upscale Boston kind of way. Em sighed. There was no point in trying to explain. Nobody understood her life. You kind of push all the guys away, Brianna pointed out quietly. Maybe not like that, but still. I don't do romance, Em replied. She was done with love, period. She'd loved her parents, and they were both gone. Love hurt too much. It was better to steer clear of it. They all ate in silence for a minute. I mean, he is an ass, Ayana said finally, and everybody laughed. Em, you up? Mike, it's a 12-hour time difference, of course I'm up. Em, like you never sleep in on weekends? Mike, fine, your text woke me. Em, I don't think that glyph is a lotus. It's bending the wrong way. Mike, it has to be a lotus. If it's not, the whole phrase is wrong. Em, the rest of the phrase never sat well with Nefertum anyway. Mike, your dad said it was a lotus. Mike, Em? Mike. Question mark, question mark. Mike. Sorry. M. Just because he's gone doesn't mean everything he ever thought is true. Mike. I know. M. If I assume all of his translations were right, I'm closing my mind. He would hate that. If I think he was always perfect, then I'm not thinking of him as a real person anymore. M. Sorry. Mike. And he feels too far away, like he's really gone. M. Yeah. Mike. We don't have to finish the map right now. It's been around for 1,000 years. It can wait a little longer. M. No. M. It's the only thing that makes me feel close to him. Mike. Okay, we'll do whatever you want. M. But I can't work tonight. Just wanted to tell you about the Lotus. Mike. Friday night plans? M. Party at Tyler's. Bob and Liza threatened to send me to a shrink if I didn't start acting like a normal teen. Mike. It'll be fun. M. Doubt it. Mike. Well, try. M. I wish you were here. Mike. Me too. I miss you. M leaned back in her chair, her hand finding the small glass pendant around her neck. Why did Mike have to live so far away? They hadn't seen each other since the memorial service, and who knew when they would again? Bob and Liza were determined to keep her trapped in Boston. No more of this unsettled living, was Liza's favorite refrain. It was hard to know why her parents had chosen guardians with a worldview so opposite their own. They'd all been friends at the University of Sheffield, but obviously, Bob and Liza.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.